So why exactly would my little brother and I have to go into foster care? Matter of fact, yes, and well, of course, she's on heroin. That could be real, I guess. But I didn't want to assume that's what it was. If we're around here assuming that the black characters in the show are criminals on drugs and deadbeat parents, then that would probably be stereotypical, wouldn't it? That word stereotypical lingers. One of the execs pulled out my resume and began studying it. The other exec wore a smile, trying to live up to what they had promised me only a few moments before. If there's anything you need, just let us know. She said, as you have seen, things move really fast around here. But we're more than happy to connect you with the writers if you have suggestions. Yeah, I said, that would be great, I said, because I'm just trying to do my homework on this. I didn't know if you guys had decided on all the facts, but maybe there's some things we can come up with, some talent or gift that we can build. Maybe he's really good at math or something. He has to be active. I'm doing my best not to play his character like a victim. So you went to Howard University, huh? The exec holding my resume interrupted, peeking over the pages. Yes, I said proudly. He slid my resume back in his desk and said, thank you for your concerns. We'll be watching you. I left the office. I shot the episode I had come in to shoot on that day. Probably the best one I did out of the three because I got what was bothering me off my chest. I was let go from that job on the next day. Phone call from my agent. They decided to go another way. The questions that I asked set the producers on guard and perhaps paved the way for a less stereotypical portrayal for the black actor that stepped into the role after me. As the scripture says, I planted the seed and Apollos watered it. But God kept growing. God kept it growing. Yet and still, when you invest in the seed, watching it grow without you, that is a bitter pill to swallow. A bitter pill. Anybody that's ever been fired knows what I'm talking about. Even if you really don't want the job, when they let you go, it's like any breakup. You act like you don't care. I didn't need that damn job anyway. I didn't need them. But when you have those moments alone, you start to wonder if there was a better way to handle it. And if you could have handled it better, maybe you could help your family. And then before you know it, you're broke. And you find yourself scraping together change just so you can ride the subway so that you can get the next job. And maybe if you could book something else, that would eclipse the feeling of doubt that's building. But it seems like you can't pay them to hire you now. My agents at the time told me it might be a while before I got a job acting on screen again. But that was fine because I never wanted to act in the first place. I definitely didn't want to be caught in going after a fake Hollywood pipe dream. I'm more of a writer-director anyway, so forget their stories. I can tell my own stories. As conflicted as I was before I lost the job, as adamant as I was about the need to speak truth to power, I found myself even more conflicted afterwards. Sometimes you need to get knocked down before you can really figure out what your fight is and how you need to fight it. At some point, my mind reverted back to my experiences here, to the professors that challenged me, struggled against me. Finally, I thought of Ali in the middle of the yard, in his elder years, drawing from his victories and his losses. At that moment, I realized something new about this, the greatness of Ali and how he carried his crown. I realized that he was transferring something to me on that day. He was transferring the spirit of the fighter to me. Sometimes you need to feel the pain and sting of defeat to activate the real passion and purpose that God predestined inside of you.
Take a deep breath to center.
God says in Jeremiah, I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a purpose than a job or career.
Left hand on the floor.
Purpose crosses disciplines. Purpose is an essential element of you. It is the reason you are on the planet at this particular time in history. Your very existence is wrapped up in the things you are here to fulfill. Whatever you choose for a career path, remember the struggles along the way are only meant to shape you for your purpose. When I dare to challenge the system that would relegate us to victims and stereotypes with no clear historical backgrounds, no hopes or talents, when I questioned that method of portrayal, a different path opened up for me. The path to my destiny. When God has something for you, it doesn't matter who stands against it. God removes someone that's holding you back away from a door and put someone there who will open it for you. If it's meant for you, I don't know what your future is, but if you are willing to take the harder way, the more complicated one, the one with more failures at first than successes, the one that has ultimately proven to have more meaning, more victory, more glory, then you will not regret it. Now, this is your time. The light of new realization shines on you today. Howard's legacy is not wrapped up in the money that you will make, but the challenges that you choose to confront. As you commence to your path, press on with pride and press on with purpose. God bless you. I love you, Howard. Howard forever.
We're almost there. We use the military press next. We're almost finished. Here we go. Military press.
I mean, the technology is great. You know, it's lots of fun, very helpful, makes a lot of things easy. But like anything in the world, there's too much of a good thing. You know? And I think one of the things we don't talk about is what's the balance of technology in our lives. And I would argue that the balance is exactly balanced. We know that the chemical dopamine is released whenever we get a bing, buzz, flash, or beep from our phone. Dopamine is the exact same chemical that's released in alcohol, nicotine, and gambling. Right? In other words, it can't be addictive. It's left unbalanced. A little alcohol is great. Too much alcohol, fun's amazing. Gambling is fun. Too much gambling, really bad. Right? Technology is wonderful. Too much technology can be very destructive and destroy our relationships. Like all addictions, destroy our relationships. And so one of the things we're not considering is what is the right balance. If you wake up in the morning and check your phone before you say good morning to your spouse, that's a problem. Right? If you have phantom beeps, that's a problem. That comes from something. Right? If you find yourself incapable of getting through a day without you check, that's a problem. Right? Now, where it gets really dangerous is with kids. Some of the ones kids have grown. So almost all alcoholics on the planet discovered alcohol when they were children.
That's it.
When we're very, very young, the only thing we need is the approval of our parents. When we go through adolescence, we now need approval from our peers. Frustrating for our parents, very important for us because it allows us to acculturate outside of our immediate families into the larger group. Right? Very stressful time. And we're supposed to learn in this time of anxiety to rely on our friends, to reach out to our friends for help. That's what we're supposed to learn. Some people, quite by accident, discover alcohol. And they learn the numbing effects of dopamine actually help them get through the stress of adolescence. This connection, unfortunately, becomes hardwired. And so, for the rest of their lives, when they face any kind of financial, career, or social stress, they don't turn to a person. They turn to the bottle. Right? Now, we have age restrictions on alcohol, cigarettes, and gambling. Because we know that an immature mind is not yet strong enough or mature enough to deal with the powers of these addicting chemicals, these addictive chemicals. Right? you've said to our adolescents, hey, I know this whole adolescent thing is really stressful, so here's the vodka, take as much as you need. That's basically what we've done. And so what we have is an entire generation that's growing up addicted. And like all addicts, they haven't learned the skill set of when they suffer stress to turn into a person. What they do is they turn into the device. And what that only does is increase senses of isolation and loneliness and can actually destroy relationships. We've all had the experience where you're with somebody walking down the street in a meeting, out for dinner, whatever, and they pull out their phone and you feel like an idiot, right? Or when you're talking to them and they're going, and you're sort of like, what's the point of this? Now take an entire generation that has no memory of a time before the device. We at least can reference times before cell phones and internet and social media. We at least have a point of reference. They don't. So this is their normal. But that's how they feel. So you have an entire generation growing up with addiction and an increased sense of loneliness and isolation. We're already seeing the results. We're seeing increased rates of suicide amongst this generation. We're seeing increased rates of accidental death due to overdoses amongst this generation. We're seeing increased numbers of mass homicides, largely performed by this generation. School shootings, over 70% perpetrated by kids born after the year 1984. Schools, universities are now dealing with numbers they've never dealt with before of kids requesting leaves of absence due to depression. We're already seeing it, right? We're seeing the effects of loneliness and isolation. We're seeing it, and yet we're not reacting to it. We're not doing anything about it. Right? And parents are a lot to blame for this. Because parents, there are some schools who want to restrict phones in schools, but it's the parents who demand that they keep their phones in case of emergency. Seriously? Seriously? When was the last time the cell phone was used for an emergency? What time are you coming home? What time should we pick you up? And if there's an emergency, you call the office, and they know what classroom your kid's in. 5 minutes, they'll bring the kid to talk to you on the phone. Like, the old way worked just fine. Remember, we talked before about innovation. It has to solve a real problem. What problem exactly did we solve? By compressing the 5-minute time frame, we added to the problem. Solve it. So that's one huge problem. So combine that with the fact you have an addicted generation that doesn't have the skill set to ask for help. Combined with the fact that they're so good at Facebook and Instagram, they're good at putting filters on everything. So they're good at showing you how smart and strong they are. These kids who commit suicide, you go look at their Instagrams, you would have no clue that they were depressed. Because they're happy and they're star athletes. Right? You'd have no clue. Because they're really good. So when we say silly things like, my door is always open, you're assuming they have the courage to come in. Combined with the fact that they're subject largely, not all, but too many, to a failed parenting strategy. Because their parents told them they were special. They could have anything they wanted. They could be anything they wanted. They got medals for coming in last, which, by the way, we know doesn't work. Devalues the medal for the one who comes in first, then the one who came in last. It makes them feel stupid because they know they didn't deserve it. Right? The kids got into honors classes not because they deserved it, but because the parents complained. And some of them got good grades not because they earned them, but because the teachers didn't want to deal with the parents. And then the kids graduate college, they get a job, and in an instant, they find out they're not special. They don't get anything for coming in last. The parents can't get them a promotion. And you can't have whatever you want just because you want it. And in an instant, they're entitled. And so you have an entire generation growing up with lower self-confidence than previous generations. So you have lower self-confidence than previous generations, combined with an inability to ask for help with things that you're struggling with. You turn to social media or device, you keep checking, you count your likes, you count your likes, you count your followers, you count your followers. If somebody unfriends you, oh my God, it's trauma. Right? The way they break up with each other, they just ghost each other, just cut each other out and stop returning texts, returning phone calls, because they don't have the skill set to say, hey, it's not working out, it's not going to get to you. Right? There's no closure. Okay? Combined with the fact that there's institutionalized patients. So, we've grown up in a world of instant gratification. You want to buy something? Go on Amazon. Shows up the next day. You want to get in touch with someone? You don't need a message on their machine. Wait 4 hours. You just text them to get back to you. You want to watch a movie? Just log on and watch it. You don't have to check times. Right? Everything happens. You want to get a date? Swipe right. You don't even have to muster up the courage to go up like, hey. You don't have to. There you go. Got a date. Right? And so the problem is, they're accused of being entitled. I don't think they're entitled at all. Not at all. I think they're amazing. I keep meeting these fantastic, smart, job. Just want to make an impact on us. And I come up and say, how's it going?
The first
and I say,
program, 1, 2, you don't do it with the weights.
I'm like, here, why? They're like, I'm not making an impact. I'm like, you've been here 8 months. And it's as if they see the summit of the mountain. It's as if they're standing at the foot of the mountain. They can see the summit. They can see the thing they want to go to. But they don't see it. It's a large, immovable object. You can go fast or go slow. I don't care. But there's still a mountain. What they don't understand is that life, relationships, and career fulfillment are a journey. There's no app for that. I got nothing. You've got to go through the slow, plumbing, annoying, meandering process called career and life.
Open up those hands off the side.
If they don't get it in 8 months, they go look for somewhere else. They don't get it. It's impatient. And because they don't have the skill set to ask for help, and because they feel lonely, so then we dump them in office environments that are built on theories from the 80s and 90s that prioritizes a number before a person. And no one really cares about their confidence and their personal growth. They're just numbers on a spreadsheet. And so they enter work cultures that don't help them. And the problem is they're entering the workforce at a deficit. I hear from kids. They tell me that they struggle to form deep, meaningful relationships, and the companies don't care. And so it's destructive to them as individuals, but ultimately hurt the company because more and more millennials are entering the workforce. I believe, to your point about solutions, that now the responsibility of companies is even greater than it's ever been before to take care of its people. Because if the environments in which we're asking our youngest workers to work in isn't built to help them, I can't even imagine what the suicide and homicide, and just the rates of depression, you know, an accidental death due to overdose is going to look like in the future. It's going to reach epidemic proportions. It's already, the statistics are already alarming, and yet it's not getting any alarming. Parents have to intervene. We have to stop giving our kids free access to social media and phones at young ages. They are not ready for it. Their minds cannot cope with the dopamine. Balance is fine. You can give a kid a phone, but they can't use it in their bedroom. They can't have it at the dinner table. They can't take it to school. They can only have it up to a certain hour, and you take it away. Your children, you can take the phone away. We've got to intervene as parents. But as companies, we now have to deal with the influx of kids that are coming into our companies with addiction. Watch, I see it all the time. Walk through any office. You'll see the older employees have their phones on the sides of their computers as they're working. You'll see the youngest employees have their phones face up in front of their keyboards between their arms as they're working. This is how they work. And the science is alarming. They did experiments on mice where they did the multitasking, they put flashing lights to mimic going from the computer to the cell phone, the computer to the cell phone, to the TV. The mice that were exposed to the changing lights, it took them 3 times longer to solve the maze than the mice that weren't. And the damage was permanent. It didn't improve when they stopped the lights. And the leadership now is even more important. And the leaders now are even more irresponsible. You are responsible for the lives of human beings, and some of these human beings are your children. So okay, but the CEO who thinks all the stuff that I talk about is craziness, and you don't have time to make these changes. This is what I hear. We don't have time. It's a war out there. I've actually heard executives tell me that. It's a war out there. I don't have time for this leadership stuff. I know guys who are bored, and I'll tell you, it's what you're going through. Take care of money. It's not war. You do have time. And if it's really that way, then what would you be doing when it wasn't doing well? It's more, it's more than an indictment that in peaceful time, there are times you're good, you weren't focusing on stuff, right? But my point is a lot of these executives have children of this age working at other companies. And my question is, would you like those other companies? Would you like those other executives to care about the growth of your child, the confidence of your child, the career success of your child? Would you like those other companies to help your kids learn the skills of social interaction, the ability to ask for and receive help? Would you like their jobs to give that to them? Set the example. Do it for other people's children. Every single employee 100% someone's daughter. 100%. And if you want someone to take responsibility for the life of your children and their company, then why don't we start taking responsibility for the life of the children?
Okay, round three. 3777.
When you do that, you stick your name, your form, and everything you see is provisional. Two things happen. Some people, they have immediate what we could only metaphorically call the dark night of the soul. They go into deep depression. Because everything they thought was real is no longer real, including their own name, form, body, and mind. Some people get so scared that they have a bad trip. Some people cross that threshold and discover nirvana or enlightenment. And they say, wow, I thought I was squeezed into the volume of a body in the span of a lifetime, but I'm a timeless being that can morph myself into any experience, including the human experience, which is amazing. But the human experience is also that which causes existential depression. So the causes of human suffering, since you brought it up, are brought up in Eastern wisdom traditions as, number one, you suffer because you don't know who you are. You confuse yourself with your body-mind experience. Number two, you grasp and cling at experiences which are evanescent and transitory and dreamlike. You say, what happened to your childhood? It's over. What happened to yesterday? It's over. What happened to 5 minutes ago? It's over. What happens to these words? By the time you hear them, they don't exist. So, you know, Wittgenstein, a German philosopher, said, we are asleep, our life is a dream, but once in a while we wake up enough to know that we're dreaming. So what do you wake up to when you cross this threshold? You wake up to your true self, which is not body or mind, but the awareness in which that experience is happening. So grasping and clinging at a dream is the single cause of insight. The third is being afraid of anything that's unpleasant. Abandonment, being treated by someone not respectful. So that's, you know, there's aversion to certain experiences. Third cause of suffering. Fourth is identifying, which is related to with your ego identity. And fifth is the fear of death. Now they're all connected. They're all the same fear. And they are not going. This is the biggest question everybody should be asking. Who am I? What am I? Am I the changing experience of this body, which is a perceptual activity? Am I the experience of the changing mind or the changing personality? Because you don't have the same personality when you were a kid or maybe even 10 years ago. What is it at the basis of this? When you start that reflective self-inquiry, ask yourself, who am I? What do I want? What is my purpose? What am I grateful for? Go into the stillness of meditation, you have what wisdom traditions have called revelation, revealed truth. Now, you know, that sounds very grand. I would say just call it insight. You know, meditation, mindfulness, awareness of body, awareness of mind, awareness of mental space, awareness of the web of relationship, awareness of that which we call the universe. It leads you ultimately to the awareness of awareness. And when you discover that, that's in the world. Now, everyday experience is modified consciousness. So right now what we're experiencing is what we call the waking state of consciousness. So awareness is modifying itself every time you open your eyes into this experience, right? And you call it the physical world. Now if you close your eyes, you have another state of consciousness where you don't actually experience the physical world. You experience sensations, images, thoughts, emotions, stories. It's like a dream. As soon as you close your eyes, you're experiencing, you might call it daydreaming, but there's no difference between a dream and what you dream at night. The physical world has disappeared, there's only a mental world. Then you go deeper at night, even the mental world disappears in what we call deep sleep. Now that is the highest intelligence, by the way, because in deep sleep, there's unconscious processing going on, there's creativity going on, there are correlations being made, there are toxins being removed, there's a whole resetting of your memories and consolidation of that. So in deep sleep, even though there is no experience of a physical or a mental intelligent, highly correlated state in which unconscious process thinking is occurring, memories are being consolidated, imagination is being refined, etc., even though you have no consciousness. So think of these three states metaphorically, like you would think of water becoming ice as the physical world, water as water, fluid, dreamy, water as vapor, even more dreamy and fluctuating and ambiguous and contradictory and difficult to grasp. But if you want a little bit beyond that, I'm speaking metaphorically, you'd end up with what is called quantum matter, which is the fundamental ground of existence according to science. But you can do that subjectively. You can move from the physical world to the dream world, to the sleep world, and beyond to what is called fundamental consciousness, which is the source of all knowing, all experience. In wisdom traditions, it's called undifferentiated consciousness. So what is reality? What we call reality, what today science calls reality, comes under the heading of naive realism. Einstein was a naive realist. And I'm not saying this in a derogatory fashion. It's a word in the science of philosophy. Naive realism means that the physical world exists exactly as perceived by the five human senses. Now, obviously, that's not true. Other species experience the world through different modes of sensory perception. The second aspect of naive realism is that the physical world, as perceived by the five human senses, would exist even if no one was observing it. Well, how do you prove that? And firstly, it's naive because we know that the world is more than what is perceived by the five human senses. So this leads us to a solution, actually, of the hard problem of consciousness, which is get rid of the idea that the world is physical. What we call the world as physical, even your physical body, is a perceptual activity. And that perceptual activity for you and me is a human perceptual activity through human consciousness, not through bat consciousness, not through mosquito consciousness, not through plant consciousness. But non-dualism says, go beyond that. There is only one consciousness that is differentiated, you know, undifferentiated consciousness, differentiating into these different species of consciousness that form a matrix of conscious beings that are collectively projecting this universe. I don't think consciousness being formless and infinite is subject to either birth or death. This is a vacation we have on planet Earth right now, and so might as well enjoy it. But death is not the end of consciousness, it's the end of a certain storyline in consciousness, a certain interpretation of perceptions, images, feelings, and thoughts. It's not that I don't think about death. I ask myself, what is tomorrow.